Brother Bradley? No. It's told almost as an afterthought. Two verses are dedicated to him. But you know what? There's a lot that we can learn from his story. Let's turn to 2 Samuel chapter 23, verses 11 through 12. And I am going to ask you to stand in honor of the reading of the Word of God. It's not for me. It's just to honor his word. 2 Samuel chapter 23, verses 11 through 12. It goes like this. And after him was Shammah. Someone say Shammah. The son of Agi, the Hararite. And the Philistines were gathered together into a troop, where was a piece of ground full. Somebody say full. Of lentils. And the people fled from the Philistines. But he, Shammah, stood in the midst of the ground and defended it and slew the Philistines, and the Lord wrought a great victory. And tonight, the title of this message is simply this: a little patch of beans. A little patch of beans. Let's pray. Lord, have your way in this place tonight, God. Anoint your servant, God. Let me speak your word, God. Let it encourage someone tonight, God. Have your way in this place, Lord. We will be careful to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. And God, we lift up our voices in worship to you tonight. Let's give God a hand clap of praise as you say amen and amen. You can be seated. So the scripture that we just read, the chapter talks about David's mighty men and who they were. Do you know what a mighty man was, or do we have any mighty men here tonight?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, mercy. I heard Brother Bradley loud and clear. The mighty men back then were David's. Don't laugh, anybody, okay? He was being serious, okay? The mighty men back then were David's elite soldiers. They were highly trained, highly skilled warriors. Today, we would call them the special forces. They could probably kill someone with a piano wire if they had pianos back in the day. And they had a very specific purpose. Their purpose was to fight alongside King David. Their purpose was to protect the children of Israel. And their purpose was to defeat the enemy. You could not be one of David's mighty men unless you had a pretty impressive resume. David was looking for men who were tough. David was looking for men who were unafraid. David was looking for men who were unstoppable. Do you know how you get tough? You go through difficult situations. Do you know how you become unafraid, Kevin? You face your fears. Do you know how to be unstoppable, Brother Knight? You just don't stop. You just don't quit. There is a scripture in Ecclesiastes chapter 3 that tells us, to everything, everything, there is a season and a time for every purpose under the heaven. Does anybody here have a purpose? Do you have a purpose from God? To everything, a time, to every purpose under the heaven. Now, the scripture that we read a few minutes ago goes on to say that it lists everything and every purpose that is known under the sun. There's a time to be born and a time to die, a time for war and a time for peace. It lists just about every situation you could possibly think about on the face of the planet. But when you read it through, there's something that is glaringly absent from that scripture, from that chapter. What is not there is a scripture that says, honey, just throw up your hands and say it's time to quit. It's all right to throw in the towel. It's not there. Go in and read it. Every shows up on the scene. And in this particular story, Shammah is out in the middle of a field of lentils. He isn't fighting. Instead, Shammah is farming in a little patch of beans. The Bible says it was a field of lentils. Do you know what a lentil is? It's a bean. It's a tiny little bean. It's a source of food. It feeds people. This little patch of beans is what stood between God's people and starvation in the winter months. Because if you had no beans, you had no food. And if you had no food, you had no life, no meat. I'm gone. Bye-bye. Okay? So it was a very valuable crop for the Israelites. Everyone say, bye-bye. Bye-bye. So it was a very valuable crop for the Israelites. They had to bring in the harvest because their lives depended on it. And Shammah is out in his little patch of beans, and he's out there working. He's not out there criticizing the bean patch. He's not out there posting questionable things on Facebook about the bean patch. He's not out there tweeting stuff that probably should not be tweeted. He's out there working. Somebody say, working. But you have to move your head like that. Working. Okay? He's standing beside his neighbors and his hired servants, and they're harvesting the bean patch. They probably have baskets in their hands, and they're picking the bean pods. And with every bean pod that they pick, they're picking up on the promise of their future. And they're busy gathering in what they worked so hard to achieve. You know, a bean patch doesn't just spring up overnight. Brother Bradley, you can't go onto an empty field and turn around a few times and say, Jesus, 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 and let's sing a couple of choruses, and boom, it mysteriously disappears. You have to work in order to get a bean patch. You have to prepare the soil in order to get a bean patch. You have to plant the seed in order to get a bean patch. You have to water the seed in order to get a bean patch. And you have to watch over it and guard it until it finally becomes a bean patch. Sometimes you have to pull weeds out of your bean patch. And sometimes you have to run off some critters and some scavengers off your bean patch. But at the end of all that toil and all that labor, is a bean patch that's ready for harvest. Finally, Brother Brandon, it's going to pay off. Finally, my promise is about to be fulfilled. Finally, I'm about to walk into God's purpose for my life. Finally, revival has started to come to the church. But there's an enemy who's been watching. And there's an enemy who's been waiting. And there's an enemy who's been plotting. And it was when the people were out in the field and they had their eyes on the harvest. And it was when they had their hands in the field. And it was when they were actually touching the promise of their future. And that was the moment when the enemy came to attack. And the Philistine army launched an all-out assault on the unsuspecting Israelite farmers. They weren't ready for it because they weren't expecting it. And because they weren't expecting it, they were not prepared for battle. Their mentality was, it's our season, so all we have to do is pick it up, right? You know, there's a difference between what a farmer wears and what a warrior wears. There's a huge, huge difference. And so the Philistines charged into for was forgotten. Everything they toiled for was broken. All the planting, all the watering, all the weeding, everything they worked for in the past and everything that they might have in the future was now being trampled under the feet of their enemy. And what should have been a time of great joy had now become a time of turmoil. And I'll be really honest with you tonight. I really believe that's where some of us are. God has given you a promise. God has given this church some promises. But it's a promise that he's given you of a greater future, a promise of greater ministry, a promise of things that you've only ever dreamed about. And God has given promises to this church, promises of healings, promises of miracles, promises of souls, and a great outpouring of his Spirit. Something we prayed for, something you've prayed for, you've longed for, and you've asked God for it, and you've watered it with your tears, and you've fed it with your prayers, and you believe God for the fulfillment of this promise. And you've had your hands actually touch up against the fulfillment of that promise. And the enemy came, and he snatched it away. And so, and you're worried, and you've drawn back in fear, and you're wondering, God, what did I do? What have I done wrong? I thought it was my season. I thought it was my harvest. Why is this happening, God? So many questions, and so many tears, and so many sleepless nights. What do you do, Sister Bradley, when you thought it was your season? What do you do, Sister Rachel, when you thought you were walking into your purpose? What do? Standing on what they thought was their promise, what they thought was their harvest. One minute they're reaping the harvest, and the next minute they're under attack, and they run as fast as they can to put as much distance between them and their enemy until all that remained were the Philistines, a man by the name of Shaw, and a little patch of beans. But, somebody say but. But what the Philistines didn't know was that there was something different about this man named Shammah. He may have been working in the field like everybody else, and he may have had his hands in the harvest like everybody else, and Shammah may have been exposed to the same set of circumstances as everybody else, but Shammah didn't respond like everybody else, because instead of hightailing it with everybody else, Shammah stood in the middle of his little patch of beans, and he dug in his heels, and he turned to face his enemy, and he said, I refuse to let you take what wrongfully or what rightfully belongs to me. You're not gonna do it. I might die trying, but honey, I'm not gonna die without fighting. You're not gonna take what rightfully belongs to me. So what is it about Shammah that made him stand? What made him different from everybody else? The Bible tells us that Shammah was the son of a man by the name of Agi. Do you know what Agi means in Hebrew? It means fugitive. It means one who runs. The name Shammah itself means death. so overwhelmed that you're without hope. And these were the things that were ingrained in Shammah's DNA. It was in his DNA to run at the first sign of trouble. And when he saw those Philistines running toward him, every fiber of his being told him, run, 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 just run. But something rose up inside of Shammah, and he pushed away any thoughts of failure, and he pushed away any signs of retreat, and Shammah just started fighting. He started swinging at anything that moved, and the first Philistine went down, and Shammah struck out again, and another went down, and again, and again, and again, and Shammah is fighting, and he's tired, and he's weary, and they keep coming one after another, and every now and again they land a punch, and he keeps getting back up. They might push him over, but he's going to get it back up, and he's going to keep fighting, ready to take down another Philistine, because the bottom line is that he just wasn't going to put up with it. And when God saw that Shammah was not going to run from the fight, when God saw that Shammah was going to stand, it was at that point that God stood up from his heavenly throne, and honey, when Daddy stands up, you know that he means business, and he came down to that little bean patch, and he stood next to Shammah, and suddenly, the tables turned, because now it's not Shammah fighting alone, it's God himself. Himself has put on his holy armor, and he's fighting alongside Shammah. And it's believed that on that one day, that between 600 and 900 Philistines were killed on that little patch of beans. One of the titles, they're called Jehovistic titles in the Bible. One of the titles for God in the Old Testament is Jehovah Shammah. It's found only once in the book of Ezekiel, and it simply means the Lord is there. The Lord is present. Isn't it interesting that by itself, Shammah means desolate? But when you add Jehovah to the equation, it takes on an entirely different meaning. Because whenever God enters the picture, things have got to change. When God steps on the scene, all things are possible. The tide will turn in your favor, because God is there and God is present in your circumstances, in your marriage, in your finances, on your job, and in your bean patch. And he's fighting for you. And you may not see it, but honey, he's there. You may not understand what's going on around you, but God is there. Jehovah Shammah is standing right next to you. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus.